St. John's United Methodist Church. On this warm day, would you please stand for our call to worship? Forgiveness is mercy. Forgiveness is unfailing love.
Such patience and understanding.
Forgiveness is overwhelming compassion.
Such sympathy and warmth.
Forgiveness is the blotting out of transgressions.
Such freedom and goodwill.
Forgiveness is the washing away of my iniquities. Please remain standing if you can for our opening hymn, Grace Greater Than Our Sins, page 365 in your red hymnal.
Thank you. seated. This is that time that we actually get to come together as a body of Christ, where we lift our prayers up for our family, our friends, or one another, and offer them to God through His grace and mercy, which we'll ask, Lord, hear our prayer. Brothers and sisters, what is on your hearts and minds today? Yes. Let us lift up Jean in God's grace and mercy. Lord, hear our prayers. Yes. John Fletcher and the Fletcher family. In God's grace and mercy. Lord, hear our prayers. Yes, ma'am. Jennifer and Reagan. In God's grace and mercy. Lord, hear our prayers. Yes, ma'am. What's your daughter's first name?
Tammy.
Let us pray for Tammy and God's grace and mercy for negative results. Lord, hear our prayers. Yes, ma'am. For Zach's family, for travel mercies, for those coming in, and also for his grandmother who just passed. In God's grace and mercy, Lord, hear our prayers. Yes, ma'am. Our unsheltered family, in God's grace and mercy, Lord, hear our prayers. Yes, ma'am. Oh, yes, sir.
I was standing in the post office in line, and I talked to a lady, a very sweet lady, who was going to come here from Jersey. And I thought her family was in the office. And her father just died because he couldn't get medication. And I don't know, it's just how people think about how good we have it here right now. What's going on in this world as well?
Let us lift up all of those that are stuck in the middle of this conflict, innocent people, in God's grace and mercy. Lord, hear our prayer. Yes, ma'am. We had 60. I know we had 55 chairs on one side, and all those were full, and they drug over more. So 60 to 65 last night for the Mayus gathering in the CLB. So let us give a joy with thanks be to God for all the powerful and Holy Spirit and the witness and the consecration of the men's team for Walk 2014. So thanks be to God for His presence last night. Yes, ma'am.
Thanks for all the service in this church.
And thank for all the service in this church as well. So thanks be to God for everyone here who is serving and on special teams and stuff like that. We couldn't do it without you. Then let us go to the Lord in prayer, shall we? Most gracious Father, we come to you today, and we humble ourselves and we bend our knee. As we lift up those concerns, those prayers for those battling cancer, those that have been re-diagnosed and has come back. And Father, we pray for those who are going for test results and hoping that everything comes out negative, that it's a positive trip. And we pray for those who are traveling to say their final farewells for a loved one. We ask that you bring your loving hands around each and every one of those families, those individuals. Father, we lift up our unsheltered today, those who are on the street in this cold, bitter weather. Let them find the light that lives in our heart, that we can lead them to shelter or offer them a warm jacket or a blanket that they may need at this time. Or maybe even a meal, Father. Whatever you direct our hearts to do is where we want to serve. Father, we pray for and give thanks for the beautiful gathering we had last night, for your servants who have taken on the responsibility to be your hands and feet as those pilgrims come to the Mayus gathering and the Mayus walk in February. We ask that you be with each and every one of them as they prepare their minds and hearts to receive and be a witness for those. Well, Lord, we're cold this morning, but the heat of the Holy Spirit and the breath of the Holy Spirit is here among us today. Warm our hearts with your word. Warm our hearts with your presence as we continue to worship you today. In Jesus' name, the one who made all this possible.
Amen indeed. If you don't mind, would you stand if you're able as we sing our centering hymn, Blessed Assurance, with page 369. If you're able, please stand. Blessed Assurance, page 369.
Our scripture today comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. But if anyone has caused grief, he has caused it not to me, but to some extent, not to exaggerate it, to all of you. This punishment by the majority is enough for such a person. So now instead you should forgive and console him so that he may not be overwhelmed by even worse grief. So I urge you to reaffirm your love for him. I wrote for this reason to test you and to know whether you are obedient in everything. Anyone whom you forgive, I also forgive. In fact, what I have forgiven, if I have forgiven anything, has been for your sake in the presence of Christ. And we do this so that we may not be outwitted by Satan, for we are not ignorant of his designs. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You know, as a pastor, one of the interesting things, or probably the most heartwarming things, is I sit with people as they're approaching death. You know, I get to sit with them, and I visit with them, and I talk to them, and I pray with them. And, you know, a lot of times they tell me their last dying words, and sometimes those words are simply expressed by their needs, very simple things. For example, could you please adjust my pillow? Or do you think you could help me get a drink? Sometimes they even express a concern about their family, about others, their final I love yous, and that it's going to be okay. But the final words that someone speaks in those dying moments reveals what's on their heart at the time. You know, sometimes it may reveal the nature of their faith and the nature of their hope. You know, John Wesley is said to have uttered these words as he was on his deathbed. He said, "Best of all, God is with us." But when it comes to the death that Christ received on the cross, when it comes to being crucified, the very act of speaking was a painful experience, and it required great exertion on their part. The thought behind crucifixion is due to the combination of exhaustion and shock, fluid buildup around their heart, and asphyxiation. It's a painful death. It's an unpleasant death. And for one to speak while they're crucified would require a great effort on their part. They would have to literally pull themselves up by the nails in their hands just to expand the diaphragm enough to get air to speak. And so for all these reasons, words were very sparse among those that were victims of crucifixion. But Jesus spoke seven statements from the cross. And we're going to get into all of those statements later on, probably sometime in February and March. But there are seven statements that are recorded in the Gospels when Jesus spoke. And there's also three reasons that we can assume that these statements are important to us. First and foremost, all of these statements, they teach us about who Jesus was, who he was as a human being, who he was, as Christ made, or God made flesh, and it reveals who God was, and it also reveals something about ourselves. You see, Jesus went through a lot of effort, and he bore a great deal of pain just to speak these words. Second, Jesus came to reveal God. He came to reveal to be God's Word made flesh. And finally, these statements were recorded by the gospel writers because they were significant in who Jesus was and what his life stood for. I want to start today about one lesson. It's on the first and final words of what Jesus spoke. And that message is, "Father, forgive them." Father, forgive them. And as we talk about the message today, or the sermon today, I want you to think about those three words, "Father, forgive them." It's not surprising that the first words that he spoke was a prayer, because that prayer is in Psalms. But what is surprising, or haunting, or disturbing, is what he prayed. "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." Forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. I want to start out our exploration today with a question. For whom was Jesus praying for?
For whom was Jesus praying for? Who is the them that Jesus was asking God to forgive? He, of course, was praying for the soldiers who so cruelly tortured him and crucified him, and who was fixing to gamble all his clothes away. So, Father, forgive them. He also prayed for the crowd who verbally assaulted him and mocked him. So he prayed, Father, forgive them. The religious leaders, from their own jealous and spiritual blindness, conspired with the Romans to have him put to death. Father, forgive them. You know, it's just astounding. Can you imagine such mercy that this has to be one of the most powerful images of Jesus on the cross as he prayed, Father, forgive them. Now, I also want to point out someone else that Jesus prayed for that day. Jesus was pleading from the cross for God's mercy to be extended to us. You see, we are part of them that he prayed for that day. Jesus was praying when he asked, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. How many of y'all remember the old gospel hymn, Where Were You When They Crucified My Lord? Oh, yeah, there you go. The answer to that, in a very profound spiritual sense, you were there. The entire human race was there at the crucifixion that day. Think about that. The death of Jesus was an event that transcended time. And the prayer that Jesus prayed gave it a voice as to what Jesus was doing that day on the cross. You see, he was offering himself as a sacrifice of atonement for the entire human race. Pleading for atonement for those that have come before. Pleading for atonement for those to come after. To hear those words that day, you and I were there in a sense when Jesus prayed, Father, forgive Leslie. Father, forgive Mike. Father, forgive John. You were there. Father, forgive those in our churches and those on our streets. Forgive those in the cities and forgive those in rural towns. Forgive those in our country and those on the other side of the world. Father, forgive them. Powerful words. Powerful words Jesus cried out from the cross. They were prayed not only for those who stood at the cross, but also for us and all of humanity. The fact that Jesus devoted one of the seven final statements to a prayer for forgiveness tells us that we are all in need of that prayer. Amen? We are all in need of that prayer. We need forgiveness because, you see, we struggle with sin. And I know I bring this up a lot, and I'm going to get around to that and tell you exactly why. We struggle with sin. Sin is that word that we prefer not to use, isn't it? We don't like it when someone says, well, you're sinning. Or we don't like it when we think, well, I just sinned. What we want to do is we want to use something just a little bit less painful. You know, like, well, we kind of slipped up. Or I kind of made a mistake. Because you see, that word sin simply means that we just strayed from the path. It simply means that we strayed from the path. That we missed the mark. The Bible implies that God has a path or a way we are all to live. But when we don't follow that path, when we stray from that path or miss the mark, then we simply just stray away from it. Traditionally, most faith traditions, they give us a list of the seven deadly sins of the world. And these seven deadly sins are the root of all evil. Y'all know what those sins are? It's in the Bible. They're listed. I believe, let's see, lust, gluttony, greed, sloth, wrath, envy, and pride. Those are the ones that most faith traditions or most churches preach about because everything is rooted from those seven sins. And when we pursue these impulses, then we step out away from God's path, and our departure leads to pain. When we sin, we become dehumanized. We're separated from God by means of guilt and means of shame, the guilt and the shame that we carry.
This also hurts the others that around us, that are around us, and it keeps us from doing the things that God intends for us to do. Some folks will suggest that Christians spend way too much time dwelling on sin and making people feel guilty. Some Christians at churches may do that, but you see, that's not the central focus of the gospel. The central focus isn't to make you feel guilty, to make you feel bad about that. The central focus of the gospel is God's grace and mercy. His grace and mercy. And so when Christianity speaks of sin, the aim is not to make you feel guilty, but to help you discover the grace and the healing mercy of God. A grace and healing mercy of God that we so desperately need. Let me put it in a different perspective. Imagine that you're having your chest pains, okay? You got shortness of breath. You start to experience pain running down your left arm. And although there's some of us that might say, well, there's nothing wrong with me. I'm okay. Or, yeah, I might be having just a slight heart attack, but it'll be okay. Chances are you need to be examined by a doctor, right? You need to be examined by a doctor. And if you leave it unchecked, then we could possibly die. See, if we're smart, then we want to know what's causing that symptom, those symptoms. The doctor tells us that we have a small blockage and it can be fixed real simply by a very routine surgery. Now, with all that in mind, would you sit there and think that the doctor is being overly pessimistic or trying to help you get better? Would you say, well, that doctor, he's such a downer, or she's such a downer, she or he doesn't know what he's talking about? And so what I'm going to do is, I know more than a doctor, and I'm going to find someone who's going to tell me exactly what I want to hear and make me feel good about my heart again. Is that something that we would do? I don't think so. I think what we would do is we would be very thankful that the doctor found the problem and could cure it. In a very similar way, that's exactly what the Gospels do. It's exactly what the Gospels do. The Gospels don't focus on sin. The Gospel focuses on the cure. You see, sin is simply a diagnosis. And so the Gospels don't focus on that. They focus on the cure. And the cure is God's grace and His gift of salvation. It's kind of like that heart surgery conducted by the divine physician who has laid down His life for us. Being able to forgive one another should make the difference between life in the church and life in our community. We often offend and hurt one another, sometimes intentionally, sometimes non-intentionally. And it may also happen elsewhere that people offend and hurt one another. However, this can't be unresolved. It cannot go unresolved. It has to be settled through loving forgiveness. It's settled through God's grace and mercy. It's not always easy to do that. And the pain of offense is real. And it's not easily to overcome. And so I leave you with this one final thought today. Does your heart and mind, your life in general, see why we need Jesus, who prayed for us and died for us when He said, Father, forgive them? I'm leaving you with that to take home. Look for Jesus. He's here. One lady's already found Him. Raise Him up. You still got it? She's got it back there. So, amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for this time that we've come to be able to hear that You love us so much that You died for us. And Father, we're grateful for the time that we have to know that the sins that we do are not going to be with us forever, that we can have them wiped away. You are the mighty physician, Lord. You can heal our hearts with Your love, grace, and mercy. So be with us. Help us to change. Help us to ask for forgiveness for our sins as we go forth and we think about the final words that Jesus prayed on the cross. Father, forgive them.
Father, forgive me. In Jesus we pray. Amen.
Please stand if you're able for our Apostles' Creed printed on page 881. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Seated. Will the ushers please come forward? Most gracious Father, we ask that you accept these gifts as fragrant offerings so that we may continue the mission that you have set before us. In Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. Will you join me in our hymnal on page 12 as we prepare for the service of the Word?
Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God,
we confess to thee and acknowledge you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. We have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Forgive us for joyful obedience to Jesus Christ our Lord.
Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God,
holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and spirit. And on the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these mighty acts of Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us, to proclaim the mystery of faith. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and vine, and make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be redeemed for the world, the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. And by your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Father Almighty, now and forever. The body of Christ, given for you. It's the blood of Christ shed for you. Will those helping with communion and music team please come up? I heard this click. I didn't know if it was still working or not. Thank you. Brothers and sisters, the table is set. Join us in Holy Communion. Go forth in peace. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Friends, will you join hands if you're able, or put a hand on the shoulder in front of your neighbor? Let's become connected as humanly possible as we recite the ancient prayer, that our Lord taught us so long ago. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Before we sing our closing hymn, Freely, Freely, got one quick announcement. There is a special called Church Conference for the 24th, I believe that's Tuesday. It's for the board, the foundation board, so they can elect incoming board members. So it's open to the church. We need you here so you can vote on that, or you can nominate anyone who you would like for that also. So it's going to be, I believe it's 6 or 6:30. Be here at 6. Sir? Tuesday the 23rd. And then the foundation meeting is going to be on the 25th, that Thursday. Right. So the 23rd. And we'll probably have it someplace where it's warm. Probably across the compound over there, or maybe in the board meeting. You know, you think we have it bad today because what, we've gotten one day without heat, and we may have to suffer one day without air conditioning. St. Luke's hasn't had heat or AC all year. So we got pretty good. So let's pray for our brothers and sisters at St. Luke's that they can get that fixed anytime soon. Please stand if you're able for our closing hymn. You'll find it on page 389, Freely, Freely, page 389. Sisters, you know, today's message, it wasn't about sin, it wasn't about that diagnosis, it was about the cure. So when you leave here today, don't concentrate on the diagnosis, concentrate on the cure. Through God's grace and His loving mercy, we are sin free. Amen?
Amen.
Go from here, bundle up, stay warm, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. God bless you.